in from the Indian Ocean, whatever it was a bright light. It pulsed and roared like a major diesel engine. Various reports place it at an altitude of 2,000 metres or a couple of kilometres, if you believe the press, but people I've spoken to a man or woman say it wasn't very high. But it came in, and about here, it apparently stopped dead in the sky. The tail inverted and shot through the main ball of light and pointed at the Earth. And there was a sudden enormous flash of light, and four white lights flashed off in cardinal directions, forming a major cross in the sky. That was the end of the visible part of the problem. Farmers around Wongan Hills and along this line heard very strange diesel engine type noises flying above them. And then about an hour later, a gentleman I know who lives on an island, Sunday Island, up north of Broome there, he heard a noise. He thought his whole family wondered what the hell it was. The whole house started to shake, books fell on the shelves. He thought a D9 caterpillar or a tank was advancing towards his front door. It rose to a crescendo. They rushed outside. Something invisible flew over the top of them, going up. So that's how we're able to draw that trajectory. It was said in the press the following day to have exploded with the force of a megaton or two at an altitude of several kilometres above Perth. Said to be a meteorite, and funny enough, it didn't get much exposure in the world press. I personally was astounded by this. I thought something with the force of an H-bomb exploding above a major city like Perth ought to have made a bit of press around the world, but no, very, very little interest at all or spread or data. Next, please.
I'm just running through strange phenomena. We'll try and relate them all a little bit later on. A Perth astronomer, John Goldsmith, has his own platform, his own cameras, his own telescopes. He lives up just outside of Armadale in the hills, not far from myself. He came out one evening and saw this orange beam hovering in the sky. Took this photograph, in fact, took four photographs. If we go to the next one, we'll just see another image of the same of the series. Although it looks daylight, it's not. He's used, being an astronomer, his cameras are set up for taking dark night photographs through telescopes. This is actually dark. This is, any light that's coming is probably reflecting off the clouds from the strange thing, which is hovering. It looks like a rocket exhaust, but I assume it didn't move. We've compared all four photographs and there's no movement. Slight variation in light intensity between them, but no movement at all. It stood like a pencil sharpened at the top end, pointing upwards in the sky. And the interesting thing is it seemed to hover above the Fremantle Naval Institute at the naval base at Garden Island. That's the best estimate we can make of the location of the thing. It's been suggested in a Japanese magazine that it's a laser. It's not. I've talked with all the people who put lasers into the air. You don't see such huge energy displays. It just hovered there. We have other reports of similar things pointing out of the ground at low level, seen up near Wongan Hills, a 45 degree angle pointing up into the evening sky. We got other reports at the time of the Banjawarn bang, that after the explosion and the seismic wave, there was a large red half-setting sun that bobbed up and hovered over the blast site and stayed there for about 2 hours. It just moved slightly and changed slightly in intensity, and then it suddenly turned off as if someone flew the light switch. But somewhat similar in nature to this, of a darker red in colour. Very big, twice the size of, three times the size of the moon, certainly at least the size of the setting sun, although it was happening about 11 o'clock at night and went on to about 1 in the morning. While it was up, dogs at the station went berserk. They obviously picked up, presumably some ultrasonic sound or some electrical interference, but every single station dog went berserk, whining and howling and jumping and pulling on leads and running off into the bush. Russian publication dealing with what are believed to be Earth stress lights in Russia over a major fault zone. This black and white image or something quite similar. Remember I talked about the ones seen up near Wongan Hills that came out of the ground at 45 degrees. This thing seen in Russia points up. Next one, please. This is another poor quality photograph, again from Russia, mountainous regions in the Asiatic part of Russia, or the Soviet Union as it was. These spheres may be similar to the sorts of spheres that were reported at Banjawarn, and as my radio broadcast went on, similar sorts of apparitions were apparently have been seen since the early 1980s, and they generally occur in the region between Kew and Agnew and south of Meekatharra, where that is of course where the Banjawarn Ground Zero was approximately where the large red soup plate observation was seen there. Next please. There was another strange correlation with the incident at Banjawarn. Banjawarn Station, time of the event, was legally owned by the Amshinriku cult of Tokyo Gassing Train. I had sent in their deputy leader 6 weeks earlier to look at a number of sheep stations in the district to see which would be suitable for them to purchase so they could get away from it all. This is the leader. Hayakawa, the number two, has an interesting career. He was working at various institutions and universities in America and in Japan on desert greening and landscape gardening studies. I've had some very good research centres. He leaves these and joins the Moonies and has very close contacts with North Korea. He then leaves the Moonies with a very large sum of money and these buildings in Tokyo, joins a very small M.Sc. cult, sets up himself with inside that, almost typical Intel cult. Ashihara is the front man, but Hayakawa runs a ministry inside of this organisation. And he then comes out to Western Australia after visits to Cameron Bays and Soviet bases, after lots of discussions inside Soviet Russia. He comes out and starts searching for a sheep station in the Leonora district and decides on Banjawarn. It's arguably the most isolated sheep station in Australia. The back of Banjawarn just is the Gibson Desert, effectively. Whilst there, he conducted some rather strange experiments. He had a piece of electronic equipment the size of a fax machine which he plugged into the ground and measured for several hours. And the sheep station owners didn't know he was doing this, but a real estate agent, another Japanese person travelling with him, did know that he did it. And he said he was measuring something for the benefit of mankind. And whatever he measured, he then number crunched all night long in a very powerful laptop computer. And when I got that information, I puzzled and thought maybe some sort of geophysical survey, but usually you would move your electrodes along a line looking for some anomalous response. You would never sit on one spot just measuring what are effectively Earth's deliberate currents. I now believe I know what he was doing, but at the time it was a bit of a mystery. Anyhow, they tried to rush the purchase of Banjawarn. They arrived with a suitcase full of cash, and the owner of Banjawarn knew all about inkjet printers and wouldn't sell. He demanded a bank check. And so ownership finally, they signed a legal document, however. So on the night of the 28th of May, when the big bang occurred, the fireball, they did actually own the station, but they didn't technically pay for it until about a month later. There were reports in the Leonora district. There was a bunch of Japanese astronomers accompanying West Australian astronomers. And up near Leonora, 2 days before this big event,
they came across this party of very strangely dressed Japanese, quite a few of them, about 20 of them, just north of Leonora. So it's quite possible that the Aum were actually in the district at the time. And I also find it pretty odd that there were Japanese astronomers a little bit further north of there on the night of the actual event. How many Japanese astronomer teams travel around WA and happen to be there for specific events? But we'll go on. Next slide, please. This is Ashihara, and this is Hideo Murai. Apparently the most intelligent living Japanese. He's now dead. He got knifed to death after the by a Korean hitman after the gassing of the Tokyo subway. Next, please. This is Hayakawa. He lives in a house, and his jailers call him Sir. The other gentlemen in that whole game live in cells, and a lot of them are for the Tokyo subway gassing. This is actually a page out of his notes, and they mentioned he was looking at uranium around Banjawarn. There are a number of small uranium deposits in the cow creeks which developed in the old in the salt lake systems there. They've been looked at in the past. They're fairly low quality, very low tonnage. And but this gentleman was interested in uranium. He took samples away with him. And after looking at about four sheep stations around Leonora, decided Banjawarn was ideal for their purposes. He also, in his notes, he mentioned going to Belgrade to see the Nikola Tesla Museum. Now, I'll backtrack slightly in this whole thing. Whilst I was researching the event, news came out of the USA that there was a Senate inquiry into the Aum and into the weapons of mass destruction, because they had intelligence that suggested these gentlemen had attempted to get hold of uranium and build an atomic weapon. And in some ways, the Banjawarn blast resembled possibly a cruise missile with a nuclear warhead. And I and the other geologists concerned began to get concerned and said, well, what if they had actually tested something there? As far-fetched as it sounded at the time, we were worried enough to contact the Australian authorities and the American authorities. That was an interesting experience in itself. I rang up the US Senate.
This concludes part two of Harry Mason's talk, Bright Skies, that was held in Perth in 2001. Thank you for watching.